Now you can hear me?
Yeah.
I'm starting to hear it. It's coming along. Okay, first off, I'd like to make an introduction here and just have you pray with me. How would that be? All right. Father, I just thank you for this time, this privilege and honor. Thank you, Pastor Glen, for allowing me this opportunity to speak and minister unto the hearts and the minds of the people. I pray your will be done, Father God, that I'll deliver these words that you've given me clearly. In Jesus' name, amen. And I would also like to call out Pastor and Brian for making it kind of tough to be up here. I mean, after last week's message. Wow, that was what Mike calls heavy. That was really something. And then Brian yesterday, talking about praise and worship, and it was just amazing. It's amazing to me what God is doing in this place. I mean, there is a move of God going on here. Do you realize that? And he's just doing it by his spirit. And I was really taken aside last Sunday by Kelly, our Sunday school teacher. And she was back there, and you could tell that her heart was into what she does. She come to serve. And she was just moving around back and forward, and she was getting antsy. She had prepared stuff all week that the Lord had put on her heart, and there weren't any children coming. And she's like, what am I going to do? And I don't remember exactly my words to her, but it was something along the line that God's going to take care of that, and I just barely got it out of my mouth when in the door they came. And she was so relieved that she was going to be able to serve the Lord. I mean, people here, it seems that we have a genuine need to be about the Lord's business, doing what he wants us to do and what he's called us to do. And it's like Pastor said last week, there's something special about this congregation with all the key people that he's placed in here. He's definitely got something in mind. And what he's put on my heart, I've been praying about it. Pastor asked me to pray back before the new year and find the direction of the Lord and things like that for the church and my life. And I always like to try to set time apart in the beginning of the year to do that. And the Lord started talking to me about neighbors. You know, I think each and every one of us have one or two, don't we? It's really something. Holy Spirit's been talking to me about neighbors, but I got to tell you, looking around at people that we live around and in our neighborhoods, things don't look so good. It's really not. People are grumpy, they're pushy, they're intolerant. I mean, most of them think it's all about them. I know in my neighborhood, I come home every day, and what I do is I'll pull over to the left side of the road because I live on the left side, and I roll down my window and I get my mail. And while I'm getting my mail, I'm opening up the garage door. Okay? So then I get my mail, I throw it in the passenger seat, and I go into the garage and I shut the garage door and get all my stuff, and I go in the house. And that's pretty much all you see of your neighbors sometimes today. Well, it's pitiful. But that's our society. Most of the time, they don't want to be bothered. They don't want anyone to come and tell them about anything or stuff like that. And it's kind of scary. I was in a Taco Bell one time, and I was sitting there with my wife, and we ordered, and we sat down, and this bunch of young people come in and sat beside us. And I'm from the older generation. I count myself in with you guys, if I can say it that way. But here's these young kids in this next booth, and they got blue and orange and green hair and stuff hanging out all over, and, you know. And I'm sitting there, and I'm thinking, Lord, how would I even begin to witness to them? I mean, where would I start? The way I was raised, I mean, I would probably offend them just starting out. And I really don't, that's not my heart. My heart is to reach them for Christ. But it's very hard sometimes because of who we are. I think the focus sometimes is in the wrong place. It's not on how do I minister to them. It's how do I fix that in me so I can minister to them. Amen? It's kind of tough. I was at the dog park one day talking about the way society is today, and I seen this brand new Jeep sitting there. Man, it was nice. Somebody had it all decked out, lifted up, big tires on it, and the nice shiny new shocks and all that. They put a lot of money in it. Had the big lights on the top, and across the top of the windshield was these 8-inch letters. And you know what it said? It said, "It's all about me." That's the society we live in today. It's really something else. The truth is, though, that we can't change people until we become changed people. Amen? God needs to do a work in us. He needs to work on our thoughts and our actions towards others. Say, what do you mean, Dave? Little old me? I've been a Christian forever. What is it that I'm doing wrong? Well, I'm just like you are. I see things that I've been taught were wrong and different things like that, and I'm thinking, uh-oh. But I got to remember when I'm pointing my finger at somebody, I got three of them pointing right back at me. And don't tell me that you don't know what I'm talking about with our thoughts and our attitudes, because you do. If you're going down the road and somebody cuts you off, how do you respond? I mean, we're all like people, right? Or say you're getting in all the stuff in your cart in the grocery store and you're getting ready to go up and then somebody cuts you off there. Do you give them a piece of that mind that's not of Christ? Does that old dead man need to lay back down? I mean, sometimes we get that way, don't we? And sometimes over a long period of time, for us that's been in the church for a long time, there's things that we just get tired of and we don't want to put up with anymore. And I think it has to do with our age. And somewhere along the line, we've given ourselves the right to treat people bad, to speak to them in ways that we shouldn't. There are things that come out of our mouth that should never come out of our mouth. Open your Bibles with me, if you would, to Mark chapter 16. What I do is I go to Luke and I move back one page. Jesus was speaking here, starting in verse 15. And he said unto them, he says, "Go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He that believes and is baptized shall be saved, but he that believes not shall be damned. And these signs shall follow them that believe. In my name they shall cast out devils. They shall speak with new tongues. They shall take up serpents. And if they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. They shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover." So then after the Lord has spoken unto them, he was received up into heaven and sat on the right hand of God. And they went forth, notice that, and preached everywhere, the Lord working with them and confirming the word with signs following. Notice in verse 20 there, it lines up with 1 Corinthians chapter 3. It says that we are co-laborers together with the Lord. He confirms his word with signs following, right? That's how he does it. The signs don't go first. They follow. Well, I got to tell you, he can't do that if we're not going. Those signs will not go first. We have to go out and do what the Lord has called us to do. He can't bless a seed that has not been planted. I believe we're at a time here where the Lord has put together a body to go forth and to do just that. A little preparation has to take place. Sometimes we got to be reminded of things. But like Mike was talking about yesterday in the men's meeting, it's really awesome when you lift up your hands, you enter into praise and worship, and then that anointing comes. The Lord starts to move. He starts to do things. It's the same when you go forth and you begin to minister, to witness to someone. Some reason or another, God just comes on the scene because he likes that. You know, he sent his son into the world for what? To redeem us. And he's still in that business today. Nothing has changed. He still wants to save people. And how's he going to do it? He's going to do it through Russ, Patrick, Mike, all of us. He wants to use our hands and our feet and be in this body by his Spirit to go forth and to do what he told us to go do. Amen? One thing about me is there's not much that makes me happy. There's not much that turns me on. But when I get to do something for the Lord, that lights my fire. That's where I get excited. And I love to watch the Lord and see what he does. He's so amazing. It's just marvelous watching him change a heart, change a life. Some of us have been in the church so long that we've become fruit inspectors instead of bearing fruit. You ever feel that way? I do that sometimes. I'm thinking, Lord, I need help. I don't know. People that's been in the church a long time, they just change. They get calloused. They get a little indifferent. And they think, well, that's not my ministry. That's not what I'm called to do. That's not where I'm supposed to go. Acts chapter 1, verse 8 hasn't changed. Acts chapter 1 tells us that we will receive power to witness. That's what the power is for. After that, the Holy Ghost comes. This is what he was talking to his disciples about in Matthew chapter 16, verse 18, where he says that the gates of hell will not prevail against the church because, let's turn there and let's look at that. I want to start back in verse 13. Because Jesus was talking about a rock here, and I believe that rock, this is my belief, that Jesus was alluding to wasn't just Peter, but it was something a little bit different. So we're in 16. Verse 13. Some reason I've got the wrong page here. Okay, there it is. All right. When Jesus came into the coast of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, saying, "Who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am?" And they said, "Some say that thou art John the Baptist, some Elijah, and others Jeremiah, or one of the prophets." And he said unto them, "But whom say ye that I am?" And Simon Peter answered and said, "Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus answered and said unto him, "Blessed art thou, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood has not revealed it unto thee, but my Father which is in heaven. And I say also unto thee that thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it." What I'm getting at here with that rock, I believe that's the rock of revelation knowledge. And neither the devil or you or I or anybody else can stop God from talking to his people and from revealing things from heaven to them. That's what I'm talking about, that rock. And I so rely on that. Every time I go up to shake someone's hand and to meet them on the street or in the store, I want that rock with me. I want that revelation knowledge to come from God so that I can speak and minister to them from my Father. Jesus said, "Without me, you can do nothing." And Jesus, he only ever did what he seen and heard the Father do. How much more do we need to be doing that? We need that revelation knowledge from God so that we can really speak to the hearts and the minds of the people that he leads across our path. Amen? Now we all know these things, don't we? At least I hope we do. But we need to be reminded of them from time to time. Here's the thing. At this time, I believe we're in a special season where we need to take and we need to position ourselves. If you want to call it being wholeheartedly towards God, like Pastor was talking about last week, he sure knows how to walk on your feet, doesn't he? But I think we need to get ourselves in a position and to set our minds and our hearts expecting God to use us and to move us in a way that he can accomplish what he wants to do at this time. And I think there's a time of preparation going on right now. It's part of the reason he gave me this word, was to prepare us, to get us thinking and our minds set towards doing a different work than what some of us are accustomed to doing. Can you say amen? Huh. I want to be able to be in a position to hear from my Father, and that means spending my time wholeheartedly seeking him and his will, praying in the Spirit always. Say, Dave, what do you mean about that, spending time? The Lord gave me a revelation a long time ago, and I got it written down in the front of my Bible. It's kind of like a little proverb. And he says, time in the Spirit is like money to the flesh. So let me ask you this. I just want to point at Jim for a minute and pick on Jim, because I like to get a little interactive sometimes. But Jim, if you got enough money, I mean enough money, is there any place you can't go?
No.
Is there anything that you can't do?
No.
If you have enough money, you can literally, in these times, you can get away with murder. What God revealed to me, it's the same in the Spirit. Now, he's given us time. We don't know how much we have. But we can choose to spend that time wisely, and we can do some, what the Bible talks about, great exploits for our Father. Yes, he would use you to do that. You say, well, how do I go about doing that? Well, we need to spend our time about spiritual things, spending time in the things of the Spirit. And a lot of people ask me, well, what are the things of the Spirit? There's a lot of them. Prayer. Intercession. Witnessing. Reading your word. I mean, you can go on and on and on and on and on. Colossians chapter 3 says, set your mind on these things above. What are they? Same thing. All the things of the Spirit we need to be involved in. We need to be involved in spending large amounts of time, which prepares our hearts, and it prepares our spirits and makes us more sensitive so that we can hear and receive from God. Amen? Do you remember Moses when he went up on the mountain for 40 days and 40 nights and how he come down and his face shone so brightly they had to cover it with a veil for 3 days? Well, after 3 days, it took the veil off. How come? See, God's Spirit is tangible. We're supposed to walk by faith and not by sight, not by what we see, smell, feel, you know. And I like to do that. I like to walk according to my faith, but I sure like to feel what my faith is like. I like it when that tangible presence of God comes, because it just lights my fire. And if we will do that, if we will separate ourselves and spend time in the things of the Spirit, in our word, in communion with God, not only will we have that, which is a great comfort, but then we will have other things. Luke chapter 6, verse 12, the word says that Jesus went up into a mountain to pray, and he continued all night in prayer to God. Those words, all night, in the Greek, you know what they mean? They mean all night. How do you do that? I mean, that's tough. 9 o'clock, my eyes want to go shut. I'm just built that way. But Jesus spent all night in prayer to God, and then he came down from there and he chose his 12. How did he know to do that? He spent all night in prayer to God. And I'm thinking, if my Savior needed to separate himself out and to do that so he could hear from his Father on high, how much more do I? I got all these things with the flesh, and I don't have the Spirit without measure like Jesus had. I need to be spending that time. I need to spend time allowing the Lord to minister to me and time for me to minister back unto the Lord. You don't hear many people talk about ministering to the Lord nowadays, do you? It's so vitally important. God inhabits our praises. He loves to be praised. He loves to be worshipped. He loves to be adored. So the famous question is this, and it's been asked over and over, who is my neighbor? And the one we ask nowadays is, why would I ever want to go there? That's very true. There was a certain lawyer in Jesus' day. We can read about him in Luke chapter 10, if you would, please. Starting in verse 25. And behold, a certain lawyer stood up and tempted him, saying, Master, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? And he said unto him, What is written in the law? How readest thou? And he answering said, Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy strength, and with all thy mind, and thy neighbor as thyself. And he said unto him, Thou hast answered right. This do, and thou shalt live. But he, the certain lawyer, willing to justify himself, said unto Jesus, Who is my neighbor? And Jesus answered and said, A certain man went down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell among thieves, which stripped him of his raiment, wounded him, and departed, leaving him half dead. And by chance there came down a certain priest that way. And when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. And likewise a Levite, when he was at the place, came and looked on him and passed by on the other side. But a certain Samaritan, when he journeyed, came where he was, and when he saw him, he had compassion on him. And he went to him and bound up his wounds, pouring in oil and wine, and set him on his own beast and brought him to an inn and took care of him. And on the morrow, when he was departed, he took out 2 pence and gave them to the host and said unto him, Take care of him. And whatsoever thou spendest more, when I come again, I will repay thee. Which now of these three, thinkest thou, was neighbor unto him that fell among thieves? And he said, He that showeth mercy on him. Then said Jesus unto him, Go and do thou likewise. Did you happen to notice where this certain lawyer was quoting from? He was quoting commandments. He was not quoting likes or want-tos or something maybe I should do. Now, I don't want to sound legalistic, but if you've given your life to Christ, the Bible says you were bought with a price. Is that right? And God has given us some commandments. I know my boss tells me, he says, Dave, you go over there and you dig up that pipe and we're going to fix it. What do you think I'm going to do? You can say, ouch, Dave, that hurts. I understand. Jesus got a little bit more bold even than that. In John 13:34, he said, A new commandment I give unto you, that ye love one another as I have loved you, that ye also love one another. Verse 35, he says, By this shall all men know that you are my disciples, if you have love one for another. We're talking about our neighbors here. Jesus makes it even more personal than that. He says, one another. That's everybody that crosses your path. You can't say, well, he's not my neighbor. He lives way over there. Who is neighbor to this Samaritan that was laying in the road? You know, you think about it today. How far would we go to obey God's command? See, I'm out at night. I got a brand new car. I'm driving down the road. I don't have my cell phone with me. and I find a bloody mess of a man laying in the road. I got choices to make, don't I? Am I going to go out on a limb and try to help this person? Am I going to take this bloody mess and put it in my new car? A lot to think about today. We have a very, very selfish society that we're living in. But if we truly love the person, if we love our neighbors as ourselves, the choice is pretty clear. Come on and get in. We're going to the emergency room. It's really something. When the rubber meets the road, how we are tested on every side. And sometimes I think, maybe I didn't pass that test too good. Sometimes I think I need to really have that love of God shed abroad in my heart anew every day. How about you? Can you imagine what this church would be like if we could all win one neighbor to the Lord and get them to come into this place this year? Just one. So you ask me again, Dave, who's my neighbor? You don't know my neighbors. They do the same as you do. They come home and I see them go in the garage and I never see them again. Well, there's ways to get by that. And what I want to encourage you to do is what Jesus did and what I try to do with Jesus. And that's to follow. I want to encourage you to get into prayer and to prepare your heart for God to use you. We're supposed to bear fruit not only in ourselves but also in others. As we look to the Lord to prepare our hearts and attitudes for service, here are some practical ways to minister to our neighbors. Pray. Number one, pray. Get before God and continue to pray. And think about what, if anything, he would address in you. Point your finger like that. Say, you. And then, you know, work on it. If there's something in you that God shows you, work on that. Get it out of the way. Because he wants to use you. I don't want nothing standing in the way between me and my Father that he can't use me. I'm supposed to be instant in season and out of season. Amen. Then seek out who God would have you to minister to and continue to spend time every day until you hear from him. Don't stop. Your flesh gets tired. But if you will press on and you will continue to knock, continue to seek, continue to listen, God will speak. So stay in prayer. Pray in the Holy Ghost. Okay. When God does lead someone across your path or brings them to your mind, you have that nudging, that unching of the Holy Spirit. One of the things I want you to do is to start by being nice. It's hard to do. That person may have just cut you off in traffic and the Lord says, that one. And you're like, uh-oh, now what am I going to do? I'm in trouble before I even get started. So start by being nice and take an interest in them. Open a conversation as often as possible and keep it centered on them and on Christ. It's not all about me. I don't want people to see me. I want them to see Christ in me. And if you can, if the Lord puts it upon their heart, you can bring them some type of a gift, a basket, a fruit basket, something like that. Invite them over for dinner. Something that maybe they would like. Invite them to church. That's a novel idea. I used to go out and do a lot of street witnessing and things like that. And one thing I never ever did, I never invited anybody to my church. The reason I didn't invite anybody to my church is I wanted them to go and be placed in a body where God wanted them to be. Well, I think God's wanting them to be in here. What do you think? I do. And be ready when you do invite them, when you do start praying, when you do start seeking the Lord for this, be ready to give them your testimony and talk about that hope that you have within you. It's been a long time since some of you have given your testimony to anybody. And I know that, and the Lord knows that. So we need to practice that. We need to bring those things to remembrance. If you've been born again, you know the experience. You know the road that you can tell someone else to travel. But we need to bring it to our remembrance. We need to allow the Holy Spirit to take our experiences and use those. Amen? Because he's going to have you touch somebody I'll never get to see. He's going to have you go and talk to someone and plant a seed. I was witnessing to a young man down at Fort Carson one day. This young man was 27 years old. This is the state of the church. I'm going to reveal it to you. He's 27 years old. No one had ever talked to him about church. No one had ever talked to him about Christ. No one had ever talked to him about God. No one ever. 27 years. That's sad. I mean, that's devastating. I witnessed to the young man, and I was telling him by inspiration of the Holy Spirit, things about him, things about the Lord, and he was crying and sobbing like a baby. It was hitting him right in that cord of truth that every man has within him. And I finally come down and I asked him, I said, would you like to give your life to Christ? He said, no. He says, I don't know enough. And if I'm going to make a decision like that, I really need to know the truth. And he walked away from me. I was working with the guy, so he couldn't get too far. But anyway, he quit his job. He ended up going someplace else. And 2 years later, I'd run into a guy at Bass Pro that I used to go to another church with. And he come up and he says, hey, Dave, and we talked. And he says, do you know so-and-so? I said, yeah. He says, well, I want you to know that he started coming to my church and he got saved. So you don't know how God's going to use you, and you don't know when. But if we have the opportunity to plant that seed, God cannot bless a seed that's not planted. Who's going to preach if there's no preacher? Who's going to be sent if no one wants to go? I rejoiced on that day to hear that that man finally gave his life to Christ. He got enough truth in him that he could make a conscious decision to give his life wholeheartedly to the Lord, and I give God the glory. That was a wonderful day. So there's all kinds of things that we can do. And once we start doing those things, we don't want to let the relationship drop or stagnate. We want to continue to build it as much as possible until it becomes stable. Then we need to do the same thing with them as, if possible, get that person you won to the Lord to work with you to go win someone else. It's a good idea. He's got a fresh experience and a brand new testimony. He's all excited about it. Do you remember what it was like when you got your first love? When the Lord finally revealed himself to you and you just was overwhelmed? There's nothing else like that. And if we can share that with someone, that's the highlight of my life. Okay, so let's look around our neighborhoods. Consider the people that you work with, that you work for and around. Like the people next door right here at the church in this building over here. How many of you know the name of that place? Good for you. How many of you know the name of that little coffee shop or that little salon? Right here, these are our neighbors. You know, there's a fire department right back here. They're our neighbors. There ought to be some way that the Lord could use us to reach all these neighbors that we have. But we have to be willing to go. Amen? So, one of the other things that the Lord had put on my heart was to pray about a season. A season of sowing and a season of reaping unto the Lord. So if you would, please pray with me. Because I would like to see this place busting at the seams. And I know each one of you have been put here for a reason. Some of you are going to go out there and you're going to witness and you're going to win people to the Lord. And some of you are going to be here for when they come in to minister unto them and to train them and raise them up. Isn't that the way God does it? That's the way he does it. Is that heavy enough, Mike? So, Father,